Okay, good afternoon. First of all, I would like to thank Mariano for inviting me to be here with you and just share with you the things, the materials we are developing in Valencia. Also, I would like to thank Sebastian and Ricardo for this nice meeting. And all the previous speakers, because they have done a very good work. Very precise of characterization. I would like to know to tell you that we come from the polymer materials. So for us in our group, we are polymeric and colloidal. So we were used to work with another kind of materials, not conducting polymers. Because conducting polymers for us, for me, especially, there are not polymers. They are kind of polymers because you cannot work with them. It's very difficult to characterize them. Okay, so we're starting, and today I'm going to. I'm going to summarize the work we have done in the Institute of Material Science of the University of Valencia during the last year, working with conducting polymers and introducing later colloidal systems, just to use all the knowledge we have in the group. So first I will talk about organic thermoelectrics and different ways of improving. We have centered our study in the electrical conductivity and the Seebeck coefficient. The thermal conductivity, we didn't measure it until 2 weeks ago, that we at the end we could measure the thermal conductivity. So maybe they change, but we have tried just to move these two parameters just to increase the power factor. So yeah, I will tell you different strategies. Okay. We have used to improve these parameters. The doping of conducting polymers, nanocomposites, that is beta hybrid materials, multi-layer systems for simultaneously improving the electrical conductivity and the Seebeck coefficient, and at the end, the test-type thermoelectrics. Okay. So everybody knows why thermoelectrics, but why organics? Because organics don't have a very good efficiency. But there are a lot of lost heat around us that can be used at low temperatures. So we would like to develop organic materials because we can use this heat that is just lost below 100 degrees. This heat loss can be generated from power generation, from electronics, from data centers that you touch your computer and is. It has a lot of heat from automobile engines, human body, etc. So conducting polymers are very recent polymers. They have discovered in the early 70s with the acetylene, the first conjugated polymer, that they have a conjugated P system, and for this can conduct the electricity. But basically, polymers are isolated materials. And they are used for this. So this kind of conducting polymers with conjugated P-systems, so they can conduct the electricity. Okay. But what are the advantages of these polymers? These polymers can be easily modified. You can tend the structure. You can do what you want. You can make your sample a la carta. They are abundant and low-cost materials. They have very low conductivity, so you don't need to reduce the thermal conductivity in general. And they have very good mechanical properties. Very good mechanical properties, typical polymers. Conductive polymers, they are better than the inorganic materials, but not so much flexible. They have quite difficulties. So most important conductive polymers are polyacetylene, polyaniline, polypyrrole, polythiophene, polythrimethyltiophene, and the PDOT. We have been working mostly on PDOT because for us has been the most easily to synthesize in the laboratory, and it's stable and it's easy to work with for us because we have tried with polyacetylene, polyaniline, and polypyrrole, and the results were not very good, and the samples were not stable, so we keep PDOT working. But what is the problem of PDOT? That the electrical conductivity is very low. How can we improve the electrical conductivity? So the first thing we can do, just do a primary doping that is controlling the oxidation reduction state of the polymer with different oxidant reductant. Normally, the PDOT alone, it does not exist. Usually, the PDOT is with polystyrene sulfonate. But the electrical conductivity of these materials is really down. So we need to optimize the doping level just to have a big power factor. The problem is that when we increase the carrier concentration, the electrical conductivity increases and the Seebeck decreases. So what we have trying to do in the lab is to control these two parameters to have the beta power factor. Secondary doping is just to change the structural configuration of the polymer. An amorphous polymer has a random, is a random coil, is like a coil. And when the polymer crystallizes, it takes a linear conformation like a rod-like. So you can take different conformation from a coil, from something linear. It depends on the conformation. The electrons can move more easily or less easily. So what is the... then we have used the secondary doping, just introducing different solvents, counterions to modify this structure and optimize the interaction between the different chains. Traditionally, at the beginning, there was just dimethyl sulfoxide and ethylene glycol where, and polystyrene sulfonate were the first solvents and counterions used to do this. Later, I will show you some results we do in the lab. And the other way we can use to improve the thermoelectric efficiency is just to mix the organic materials with the inorganic materials, because the inorganic materials usually have a bigger Seebeck coefficient or some of them higher electrical conductivity. So we can blend. This is a traditional way has been done in polymers, just to combine two materials to have a beta materials with the properties that we decide. So I'm going to show you different examples we have done in the different ways of increasing the electrical conductivity and the Seebeck coefficient. So the first is the doping of the polymer. Okay, so we synthesize the PDOT in the laboratory. To do this, we use the electrochemical deposition. For the electrochemical deposition, we need a working electrode, a reference electrode, and we use three electrodes. So the problem is that we want to synthesize the PDOT on a glass substrate or a PIT substrate. These are not conductive, so we cannot use this method. To do this, we cover a glass substrate with a very, very thin layer of gold in an evaporator. Right? This was just to make it conductive, okay? And then in a three-electrode cell, we insert the monomer, that is the edot, and different cells changing the size of the counterions. So you use lithium chloride, butyl 3-dimer ammonium hexasulfato, and this one. So from these studies, we have increased the counter-ion size. So just to, well, we'll see later. So like this, we select the potential and we start the polymerization of the edot on the gold surface. So we obtain a very thin film of P dot on the gold surface. But now to determine the electrical properties, we need to evaporate the gold. So the first, this is the film that we obtain with the gold. With a solution of nitric acid and chloric acid, we eliminate the gold layer, and this was the film we have obtained. Okay, we have controlled that all the gold was outside, and we did different experiments to be sure that this was okay and the properties were good. We have a look at the film by electric microscope, and it was, we repeat, the process was reproducible, so we use this kind of things. So to increase the electrical conductivity, we make a reduction with hidracina, with hidracina, okay? This is a chemical reduction. So we put our film in a close place with a vapor of hidracina, and we keep it different times, and we determine the electrical properties. We have measured the electrical conductivity with the van der Poel method, and this with the four contacts and the Sieber coefficient with the two contacts. Okay, so these are the results we obtain with P dot and the four different counterions. Okay, so you see we measure the electrical conductivity, and the Sieber as a function of the reduction time of the hydration. So for the three systems, we obtained that the electrical conductivity was decreasing, the Sieber was increasing, and we have an optimum value at intermediate values of the reduction time. And we realized that as we increase the volume of the counterions, the conductivity increases quite a lot. So for this system, then we determine the thermal conductivity with modulated differential scanning calorimetry. That is not a good method, but was what we have in the lab. We have obtained values that we thought they were okay. And we calculated at this time the value of theta t. We obtained a value, the 0.2, that was at this time was very high, and is one of the highest we have obtained in the lab. We have not obtained any values so high. But this data is reproducible. We have done it again and it was okay. So what was the explanation? We have, during the day, everybody has talked about the problem of the different morphology and the influence on the morphology and the electrical conductivity. So for this system, we obtain that with the counter, the less volume counterion, we have the P dot like a coil conformation, and we have a surface with ground boundary. When we increase the size of the counterions, we have like a more soft and interconnected structure, and we increase more the size of the counterions. It's like the polymer has developed, has strained, it's much like a rigid rod, and this is the reason we think that the conductivity and the parameters change in this kind of system. So we increase the interconnection between the different polymer conducting polymer chains, so we increase the conductivity. So this is the structure. Okay. So, and now how the reduction with hydration was not very safe and not very was difficult. I was very reluctant to hydrating and not very safely. So we tried to use the electrochemical method. For this, we did cyclovolta-ampliometric curves to know how is the oxidation and reduction potential, because changing from the oxidation to the reduction potential, we can change the state of the polymer, so we have changed the conductivity. So we did this with pilot and polypyrrole films, just the same way I have explained before. And we use a 3-electrode cell to change the potential and study just changing the voltage, how the electrical conductivity and the Seebeck change. So this case, we see also that the electrical conductivity increases, the Seebeck will decrease, and we have an intermediate voltage, a higher power factor. The values are not very high, but at this moment, the values we obtained for the polypyrrole were the best one in the literature. And we didn't find, we have not gone with this polymer because it's not very friendly to work with it. So this was just to find a method to just develop the polymer and modify the conductivity by higher values. Okay. Another way of increasing the conductivity is just to make hybrid materials. The first hybrid materials we did was just to mix pidot PSF with expanded graphite. Expanded graphite is conductive, and so the problem is that we have to disagglomerate it because it's not very well dispersed. This is the problem when we mix an organic and inorganic materials. Trying to find a good dispersion is the best problem, and we need to compatibilize both of them. So this system, we find that, as we expected, that we increase the amount of expanded graphite, the conductivity increases, and the Seebeck levels off. So we observe that we have different layers of the expanded graphite with the p-dot inserted in the middle. This is what we obtain at the end. Then we leave the graphite and we went to the carbon nanotubes. So as all the methods we have tested, the best one with the electrochemical deposition of p-dot, so we make a working electrode with carbon nanotube. So we make a dispersion of carbon nanotube and we have the working electrode with carbon nanotubes. With the 3-electrode set, we electropolymerize the p-dot on the electrode. So we have like carbon nanotubes p-dot interconnected. We look at the microscope and we see this is the carbon nanotube structure, and then this is the p-dot on the carbon nanotube. And what we did is just to increase the conductivity of the substrate, we put different layers of carbon nanotubes. I will explain later how to make the layers. Okay? We put 20, 30, 40, 50, 60, and 70 layers of carbon nanotubes. And we observe that the conductivity increases and then decreases. So there is like a limit of layers that is the polymer cannot go into. I think that is don't have the mobility to go inside. So the conductivity reaches a maximum. So we selected 30 layers and a polymerization time of 30 minutes to do different approaches subsequently. With these materials, we make a device. Here, this is a PET film. On the PET film, we make a carbon nanotubes deposition, and on the carbon nanotubes, we put the P-dot. But between one and another, there was an stripe, so there was a hole. And we connected this with, this is very nice, but I have another, with copper, and we measure the power at different difference of temperature. So with a difference of temperature of 10, 20, and 30, we obtain a power of maximum of 1, of 2.5, of 5.5. And this was, for us, was a good result because we can similarly, and the device was made in the laboratory, and we are not engineers, we are chemists. So it was quite good by the time. So just keeping in mind to increase the Seebeck coefficient, we thought about perovskites. So we did perovskites by the thermal method. We made different kind of perovskites, and we mix the perovskites with the P-dot PSS. We find that the conductivity didn't move more, decrease, the Seebeck increases, and just we leave this work because we are not specialists in carbon in perovskites, but we wanted to know if there was a possibility of changing the properties. But for us, it was not a very friendly system to work with for our purpose. Because really, we want to work with flexible materials that we later we can do mechanical properties, we can do another kind of characterization, not only the thermoelectrical properties. Okay. Another system we have done is the polymerization of P-dot on the substrate, and on the top we have polymerized tellurium from a solution, just changing, looking at the potential that the tellurium can be electropolymerized at different times. With this system, this is what was quite flexible, the material. We obtain a decrease in the electrical conductivity and in the, a decrease of the Seebeck coefficient. What we think in this system is there is not a when interconnection between the P-dot and the tellurium. There is just one thing on the top of the other, so the properties do not increase quite good. Okay, so now I move to another way of modifying the properties, that is the multilayer system for improving. Now, okay, as we know, we can improve the electrical conductivity and we can improve the Seebeck coefficient. So we want to improve both at the same time. To do this, we use a multi-layer system. So what we did this is we do what we call layer by layer assembly. This is a good method because it's very simple. We can use it at ambient temperature. It's a very cheap technique if the materials are cheap, because if not, it's not cheap. The layers are very stable. We can self-regulate, we can modify the layers, we can combine a lot of things, and we can do a lot of multi-layers. So the method consists in to have different layers that interact and keep together. So the way we use is to combine positive and negative layers. So first of all, we have our substrate, we put a layer of positive, we rinse with water, we dry, and we add another solution of another component that is negative. So like this, we can have different bilayers. One bilayer is formed by the positive and the negative counter ion. So with this, this material can be obtained at ambient temperature. We can control the nanoscale morphology, and we can take we can have different properties depends of the materials we combine together. To do this, we bought a robot because otherwise we have to go inside and outside of the solution. So here we have the different solutions. Okay, the method is cheap if the component is cheap. So with the difference of the kind of nanotubes, which can be cheap or can be expensive. Here you put the substrate, and there are two tubes, one that takes the water and the other takes the air, just to rinse and to dry. So this goes up and down, goes from the solution, goes up, push the water, the air, and goes to the other solution. So you can control the type of dipping, the type of rising, the type of drying. Okay, so the procedure is more or less like this. So you have a positive solution and a negative solution, and we put the substrate in the positive solution, you rinse and dry, and you dip in the negative solution. So the layer, the bilayer is formed by the positive and the negative. And we can combine organic and inorganic materials, because you can combine P-dot with P-dot, P-dot with carbon nanotube, or whatever you want, as you find a positive or negative counterion that makes them together and establishes them. So you have to control time of rising, time of deposition, etc. So to do this, we can do this with the solution of carbon nanotube, but just to use the colloidal knowledge of the group, we synthesize pedo nanoparticles. To do this, we use E-dot. We made addition of iron to oscillate, and when we add the oxygenate water, it makes the reduction of the E-dot. Then we have the polymerization. We have the regeneration of iron from 2 to 3, and we have the P-dot. We have nanoparticles of P-dot with iron on the surface, and we positive charge. These particles, these are the image of the particles. We use different proportion of the monomer of the E-dot and the iron to oscillate, just to have a look how is changing the morphology. This is the 1.1, 1.5, and this is 1.2. Okay, we determine the zeta potential, we find that there's a positive potential, and we also determine the Seebeck and the electrical conductivity just to choose with a proportion what is the beta for us. So this was the positive layer. For the negative layer, in this step, we select the carbon nanotubes. So we put the carbon nanotubes, we dope it with a negative surfactant. So we had on one part the pedo nanoparticles functionally sized with PDDA, and the carbon nanotubes functionalized with DOC. This is a negative, this is a positive. So we have a positive and negative layers. We did this with multi-wall carbon nanotubes, double wall and single wall. And we easily can change the number of layers. So at the end, graphically, we have the PAT substrate with the P-dot and the carbon nanotubes, okay? just adding a DOX surfactant or a PDDDA. We trade with different surfactants because it depends on the surfactant. It's not so stable, the villages, and it's like dust. So at the end, we found this was working well. We obtained the different samples, and we determined the electrical conductivity and the seabed, changing the proportion of the monomer and the reductant, and the number of villages. So we found that around 30 villages. So we found that with single wall carbon nanotubes, the properties were higher, but this was expected for us. But this single wall, we don't know how to do the single wall. We have to buy them. So these were more expensive than the others. But we found really that was an increase of the electrical conductivity. Also, there is an increase of the seabed coefficient. So we can have a compromise between both of them. And we can use this system to make later device. So what we do is just to try to find the best system to make a device and obtain pues, the better efficiency as we can. This is the power factor of the multi-wall, double-wall, and single-wall, and the, as a function of the number of layers and the initial composition. Okay, so there are quite good values looking for the typical organic system. So then we try another system just using the electrochemical deposition of P dot on the PIT horion substrate. So on this P dot that is just conductive, we can make the electrodeposition of tin sulfide, and to improve the properties, is just we dope with silver. So we make a study to know which kind of silver is better to increase the properties. We selected the quantity of silver, and we did the synthesis at different temperature just to know if the temperature was influencing the deposition. So for this system, we also find good results just in the line of this kind of system. This is a system, it's easy to obtain them. The only problem with this system really is you have to eliminate the conductive surface. So this is another way to just to mix organic and inorganic materials and to have good properties. So now we have used all this knowledge to make textile thermoelectrics. We have used different textile thermoelectrics like cotton or acrylic fabric. And the first problem, we wanted to use the electrochemical deposition because for us is the, we can control very easily the deposition and the properties. So to make conductive the fabric, we make an assembly of different layers, different V-layers with carbon nanotubes. For this, we have positive and negative carbon nanotubes. And we just dip the fabric into the solution different times, and we can have the villages we want. Then, when we have the fabric coated with carbon nanotubes, we make the electrochemical deposition of P-dot on the surface. Here we have in the first row the semi-mass of the uncoated fabric. We can have the fabric just without nothing on the top. Here we have the coated with carbon nanotubes that is like deposition, and we and then when we polymerize the p-dot on the surface, we have the traditional structure of this material as polymerized and as it. So for this system, this research, we have determined the electrical conductivity on plane and also with dielectrics. The problems here that as the has a deep, is not completely flat. So we think that the electrical conductivity is basically we measure from one side to the other. So these results are made with a dielectric as a function of the frequency. Because with this also, we want to find all the different transitions in this kind of system. Because with the traditional methods we use with polymers, that the differential scanning calorimetry or dynamic mechanical analysis, we cannot find anything in this system. But with dielectrics, you can study all the transitions. So this study just showed you the electrical conductivity as a function of the frequency with the acrylic fabric, just the fabric without nothing, with carbon nanotubes and with p-dot. So the conductivity increases as we waited, and also the Seebeck increases. Then with these fabrics, we make a home device. We put here the fabric with carbon nanotubes and p-dot. We have a silver paste. We have the adhesive copper foil, the tin and an aluminium wire. And then we put together in series different squares made like this, and we may determine the voltage as a function of the load resistance and the power output. And these are different results obtained with different squares. This one is with 30 connected in series. It's only P, we don't have N materials only. So we thought that those are quite good results. So now we have translated the knowledge we had with the deposition of p-dot to the fabrics. So now this is the last results. We are working with this now. We have the felt with different layers of carbon nanotubes, and we polymerize the p-dot with the different cations. So we expected that the more bigger, so we will have better results. The p-dot is well polymerized on the fabrics. And these are the electrical conductivity. This electrical conductivity is measured also with the dielectrics. And the Seebeck is measured on the plane. The electrical conductivity increases as we calculate also. The Seebeck is also, and we have a very good values of the power factor, 0.008. So, and also what is important is that the felt is stable. You can bend it because also we can make different bending tries. We have made differential scanning calorimetry. We have determined the mechanical properties and it's stable. It's quite stable without making any protective process because later you can protect the surface and so on. Here, we determine the whole effect to see, and we have the number of carriers is the same, and the number of conductors increases. And this is the last results. At the end, we have made equipment to determine the thermal conductivity. I don't know I don't know why, because I didn't, this was Andres, who did this, but after 3 or 4 years, we have determined the thermal conductivity of these materials. We have calibrated the equipment, so we think that these results are reliable. Okay, it may say on it's like it's vertical, but these are results from about 2 weeks ago. So these are the values we obtain of the thermal conductivity, and this is the values we obtain for the theta T of this textile. So with this textile, we are now building different devices to find what is the power voltage. This is just preliminary results we have done just 3 weeks ago. We are combining the different, this is the different fabrics joined together with silver and with the copper. And we put a difference of temperature and we measure the output voltage. Here is the difference at 25, 35, 50. And this is the value we have obtained at the moment. It depends of the modules you can connect, because the value of the output voltage can be improved, and it can be better design, of course. This was to play with this, because otherwise, if you have the material and you have a high values, it's nothing more. So we are quite happy with this, with the results now. Okay, so this is more or less a summary of the system we have been working in Valencia. The idea is to combine organic and inorganic materials, and for us the best way with this kind of system, because we have trying to synthesize a polyaniline from a solution with electrochemical method, and we didn't have good results. Really, with PDOT, for us, if you have a conductive electrode, is a very, very, very good method to obtain a very good layer, stable, very consistent. So for us, the combination of PDOT and carbon nanotubes was is quite promising. It's cheap, can be modulated, is flexible, and no sé, puede tener, can be can be. So thank you for your attention, and also thank you for the to all the people that were seen in the lab. Okay, thank you for listening.
Thank you very much, Clara. Yes, we. Yes, we. So we have questions and comments. Sure.
Hi, Maria.
Yes, so first of all, thank you very much for this really interesting talk. I especially liked the part of the fabrics and the and implementing these thermoelectric materials on these textiles. I just curious about, could you elaborate a bit more about how you do the deposition of the carbon nanotubes of these fabrics in terms of which solvent do you use to disperse the carbon nanotubes, and how much time do you decide to put your fabric inside? And I was wondering as well if this is stable over time, or the carbon nanotubes just was out after a while. And then I'm also curious about what kind of fabric do you use, right? Because I guess there is not a standard where you can go to SigmaAldrich and buy piece of cotton or a piece of something. No. So what kind of fabrics are you using? Yes.
First of all, we use cotton fabrics, cotton that you can buy in a shop, in a textile shop. And then we went and we bought fieltro. Fieltro. It's like, you understand. So we buy fieltro in a shop, in a textile shop, and we have the big, and we use this. So the idea is to use a textile that can be used to make clothes, you know. So Why we choose the fieltro? I don't know, because it was esponjoso, so soft, is deep, absorbs was the water, the absorption was very good, and the because also first we did I don't have the data here, but we make a example with cotton and with the felt. The felt fabric is the like the fieltro. And with the felt fabric was much better the results, because it goes more in together, because it's more not so compact like the cotton. The so we select it, but it's just we have a big piece of fabric from the shop and it's like this. The idea is in the future to try with the different type of clothes, because the idea is I know that the big laboratories, they are doing this just to take the fabric that used to run and to try if you, for example, you run 5 kilometers and you can have another. This is what the idea, not us, is there for a lot of people trying to find here the sun is nearly all the year and to do this. So, but it's just no Aldris, nothing like this. No, like this, because at the beginning we have selected fabric and we use a lot because we cut and we use a lot at the beginning, because at the beginning you just touch the felt and was dust, a lot of dust. But now we think that the procedure is quite stable. You can do the list, it's reproducible. You can keep the sample and mesh after 1 month and we have the same values. So we think, and for this we have tried different surfactants because there are another part of the group comes from the colloidal system. So they know quite a lot with surfactants. So this has been a lot of synthesis, a lot of procedure, a lot of time in the laboratory with a lot of final degree works, just trying different systems. But with this system, PDDA and DOC, we think that we have good systems. So the important thing, in we have the carbon nanotube dispersion, they are very stable. So we have tried, we have lived in the laboratory for 1 month, it's stable. And we have the two solutions and just you dip. And also at the beginning, we have to learn how much time you have to dip, to go out, to drink, to clean. But this is, I think we are 4 years with this. So yes. And at the beginning we did this by hand and then we buy the robot. So now it's very easy. Now it's, you just leave the robot working and it's like this. But it works well.
Down.
Yes.
Why? Why is it going down after some?
We think that because you have too much layers, they like collapse, the conductivity collapse, they are no good interaction, they are no good mobility between them. Mm-hmm. And because we have the layers and we have the pivot on the top. So if you have 30 layers, the pivot can go into the different layers, and I think that with 50 you cannot go so bad, because it's like a wall that impedes that the pivot goes at the end and polymerize.
Because from what I remember, in the layer-by-layer deposition method by Descher, they have two types of growth modes. One is really layer-by-layer, and the other is kind of so-called exponential, where the roughness grows very much. It becomes like...
First, we have the bilayers, yeah. And later is the polymerization.
Yeah, but it's really depending on how the morphology looks like, because if you have really a film, or if it gets really rough and it's no longer really a uniform film. It has been observed in layer by layer deposition that it becomes really not rough, very rough at some thickness. But maybe you have some images where you can show.
Not here.
Okay, but...
But... No problem. You have to be careful, because sometimes, for example, with the fabrics, because I don't have an image, the fabric without carbon nanotubes is completely white. But with carbon nanotubes, sometimes we are green, sometimes we are darker. So we have to take care of how is doing the deposition of the layers and how deep is inside. But when we select the time and the times and the weight, at the end we have all the samples are more or less the same. The same color when we look at them. But we first do the layers, we have the layers, we do the deposition. So you have mobile layers, the idot don't go so deep in at the end, because also goes through one side, not through the two sides. And also to make the deposition, we have to make a special connection because otherwise polymerize on the top of the cell. So we have to put the ito and the polymer together, so the clap is quite special also to get this. So at the beginning was quite yes, we had on the top was white, later was gray, but you have to control all the experimental process to have it.
Do we have more questions or comments?
I have two slightly fundamental questions, I guess, when it comes to the processing of especially the start with the gold layer. So when you have the p-dot and you polymerize from the gold layer, it's grafting from polymerization, so the p-dot is attached to the gold, and then you remove the gold, but the p-dot stays on the glass. What is the mechanism of that? How does it transform onto the glass?
We just think that the goal is goes through the p-dot and goes out. We have checked if the properties before and after the surface, we have repeated the process. We have used this method a lot of times, mm-hmm. Thousands of times, and every time we have the same results. So we think that we don't know exactly what is the process. We just think that the solution attacks directly the goal. The goal goes out of the p-dot and does not attack the p-dot.
Have you done mass QCMD quartz measurements?
Yes, we did with Raman. We did a lot of characterization yes, at the beginning, because we wanted to be sure.
Okay.
Because this is for us also what was difficult was just by chance to do this.
Okay, that was one. And the other one was about the colloidal p-dot particles. So the particles are being stabilized by positive charges around it, but the p-dot is inherently already positive. So how is that a stable colloidal particle that way?
How is it stable? The color?
Because
first has the positive because the p dot we have is negative.
The p dot is negative.
Yes, yeah, the one we have, because later we put the positive on the top. This really was done, but the p dot was positive, and then no, pero es que esto. Okay, I remember. Okay, the p dot is positive, but this is a surfactant that is just adding more positive charge, but this. We talk with different surfactants, and this was the only one that was stable on the top. But this, what does is just to put apart one particle from the other.
Steric stable.
Yeah.
Okay.
More than joining together.
Yeah. Okay.
Because we wanted to have nanoparticles stabilized in the solution. So we just try with different surfactant, and with this one we found that was the best one. We different, I think, with 10 different surfactant.
Okay, that's interesting that that it's a steric stabilization using a Coulombic species that goes against that stabilization. But okay, that's
this was done by the colloidal person in the group.
Okay.
That is a specialist in colloidal particles.
Okay.
So I trust him.
thanks for the talk. Just a small question. Is there any advantage in using this gold? Because you need the gold to make the glass conductive to make the polymerization. Why not to use an Ito glass substrate?
We tried also with the Ito, but later you have to measure the properties. So the Ito was you cannot take the film out of the substrate, because the film is just connected to the substrate. So if you want to determine the properties, you cannot do this. This is the problem with this kind of system.
Okay.
Because this is perfectly attached to the substrate. This method is very good to have a very good adherence between the substrate and the polymer chain.
Thanks.
Anyone else? No? Okay, then let's thank Clara again.